Hi, Mark. I will interview you about your experiences with open educational resources. You are a professor of Dutch and academic communication at Radboud University. Mm-hmm. I also work at Radboud University as a librarian. Well, let's start with the first question. Can you tell about your work with OER or open pedagogy more broadly? How did you, for instance, come to be involved in open educations?
Well, I guess my first step was that before I worked here at Radboud University, I worked at Leiden University. And at some point, about 6-7 years ago, they were very actively involved in producing MOOCs. So they had a strong policy on that. And then at some point, so I think the first ones were all very aimed at professionals. I'm in the humanities, and that was supposed to be less professional. So they were a bit hesitant about that. But then at some point they thought we want to do that as well. And I made a MOOC then, which turned out to be very big, which is still running. It has about 150,000 participants, a MOOC on Coursera. On linguistics, so an introduction to linguistics. The title is Miracles of Human Language. You can still follow it if you want. And that was a big pleasure. So to make a real introductory course on this for a large group, to learn how to interact with such a large group as an individual professor, in my case, to see everything what was going on. So since then I've been dreaming of doing more. Radboud University, actually, I think at Leiden they have more or less abandoned this very active policy of producing MOOCs to some extent. But here at Radboud, it was never really in place, to my regret. Actually, I regret a bit that MOOCs seem to have been a fashion of 5-6 years ago, and it seems to be a little bit out of favor of some boards, university boards. In any case, I came here, and then basically what you can say is I then grabbed the opportunity of COVID-19. So the day when it was announced to us by the board in I don't remember the exact day, but around 15th of March, I think 18th of March, the university board announced to us that the university would close, all teaching would move to online. And then I thought, well, if that's going to happen anyway, and we're going to record classes anyway, why don't we try to do more with that than just show it to our own students? So I've been then involved in a project which we called Quarantaine Colleges, or Colleges Class in Dutch, so University Class in Dutch. And where we try to collect as many of these kinds of home videos made by professors teaching classes. And I made my own. So actually, I also took the opportunity to record my own class, and I'm still using that now. So here at Radboud, at this point, we're basically back to normal teaching. But I decided to use this as a kind of informal flipping the classroom. So I'm using the classroom hours now for discussing exercises, and I'm asking the students still to watch my online videos for the classes. I guess that's my basic involvement in online teaching. I have to say that I'm very interested also in outreach, and I think I can say I'm quite active in outreach activities, including on video, and the borderline between those two things is sometimes a bit unclear in my case. So for instance, this Quarantaine College, I made together with an organization which is called the University of the Netherlands, who present things which they call colleges or also call classes, but which are really more like TED talks by Dutch university professors. So as I said, so the boundaries between those two things are sometimes a bit unclear, but in my head they're very clear. I think in my head there's a big difference between online teaching and outreach.
Okay, yeah, I think it's a fantastic work you have delivered. Have librarians supported you on that open education journey in Leiden or Nijmegen?
No, I can't say they really have. Also maybe because we didn't ask for it. So in Leiden, this was the Leiden thing was, so first was a MOOC, and Leiden had a contract with Coursera. So Coursera was responsible for most of the technology. In Leiden, there was a lot of support on content and on like developing questions, this kind of thing, like multiple choice questions, which can be answered by 100,000 people. We didn't really ask for, so we didn't need library. So I guess you can have librarian support in two ways, maybe on content, but probably more specifically on keeping the material. In Leiden, that wasn't really necessary. I think for this, let's say the more recent project, it could be helpful to have more help of librarians to keep everything in place. And also, I hope we're not going to, not just me, but nobody is going to go back completely to the old normal. And we're going to still use this opportunity that now everybody knows how to talk to their camera. And because I think it's such a great opportunity to have that people can, that like people have done a certain study program 20 years ago, and they can go back to the classes they followed maybe 20 years ago to see what's new, right? Or people who are really interested. So one of the things which really touched me in this MOOC was that at some point I got an email by a then 13-year-old girl from India whose mother had said, well, why don't you do a MOOC? Because she was bored in school. She was apparently very talented. So her mother had said, why don't you do a MOOC? And she did ours and she liked it. And she came to us to tell us that she liked it. And now, just before COVID, I got an email from her that she was accepted at some top tier American university for doing linguistics. So that is, I don't know, that's basically my dream with all of this, to have a...
Wow, that's fantastic.
Yeah.
And you've already answered it a bit, but who has benefited from your open education as well at your institution as well as beyond your institution? And what would you say have been the key benefits?
Yeah, so I think within the institution, so within the university, the key benefit, I think, is for me and my students, so for my own course, it is that I think the course has improved by this, because there's basically more time, right? So because I need to spend less time on explaining things. Well, the students need to spend a little bit more time on watching my videos, but assuming they do this while washing the dishes or something like that, I don't think there's a lot of time lost there. And I hope this is true, and I think I can see that this is true at least for some other people as well. And so people who were involved in this overall project. I think it has also helped indeed for, so it's probably less So one reason why I think it's different from outreach is that it's really, of course, it's real classes. So it's aimed at people who have first have some background knowledge already, and second have some real interest in really knowing the details of something, right? So it's not just telling some nice, funny story. It's real serious stuff. But there's a lot of people who are interested in this serious stuff. And that's both true within the context of Nijmegen or the Netherlands or more broadly, or well, I even refer to the world, right? So there's many people, we know so many things, we teach so many things, and it's so easy to make them accessible to those people who are interested in this. And then again, I didn't emphasize this enough, but in Leiden, people were quite hesitant at first for doing a linguistics MOOC. So what I remember is there was one on terrorism studies. It was things like this. And they thought, well, what we are doing is just funny, and why would people want to do that? But then it turned out we were actually the most successful of all those MOOCs. And that's because, so linguistics is typically not something you need for your profession, but it is something which many people find interesting because it tells them something about themselves, about their lives, about what it means to be a human being. And so one thing I really liked is that also for the MOOC, going back to the MOOC, is that it is used in some universities. I'm not sure whether there's any university in the Netherlands anymore, but abroad, it is sometimes used as a some kind of entrance requirement for a program. So okay. There's a program on speech therapy for which you do not need to know a little bit about linguistics. And then what they do is you follow this MOOC, they do their own tests afterwards. But the material is in our course.
Okay, so it's released with an open license, the MOOC. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. It's completely open. Yeah.
Okay. I think I will follow it. I'm also interested a lot linguistics. Yes. What do you see as key successes in the open education movement so far, starting from your own experience?
I think it is this. It is this. For me, this is connected. For me, it's clearly connected to the open access movement as well. The main achievements is having been able to set several steps in the direction of what I see as the ultimate goal, namely everything you would want to know about anything is accessible at all different kinds of levels, so from an introductory level to being able to read all the papers. But more important than that, I think, is that what you can see is the attitude has really changed towards this. Not always entirely for the good. So I briefly referred to the somewhat unfortunate fate of this concept of MOOCs. Mm-hmm. So it was. And I think the problem there is that it was also presented in the beginning by some as a kind of replacement of live teaching, which it isn't and which it never can be. And I don't think we ever saw, or any of the Leiden team who were doing all those MOOCs ever sawing it as that. So it was never seen as replacement. I think that was the reason why, for instance, here in Nijmegen, they were hesitant about this. It's also good to be hesitant about it, because it is a real danger, especially in these times now, that people say, well, everything worked perfect online, so let's do everything just online.
Mm-hmm. That would be rather boring to have everything just online.
No, it's not just boring, but I think there are many things which in the end you can only learn from being physically present in a classroom. That is an important thing. Being physically present is an important thing. But It's not a replacement of that, but it is a replacement of books. It's a replacement, I think, of many of the sort of bigger, talking to a big crowd where there is no real personal interaction anymore. So it can never be replacing working in small groups with students, and that should always be part of any kind of program. But it was a little bit presented as such.
Mm-hmm.
And that made people, I think, hesitant. So to work with it, to go on with it. So that's a bit regretful. But I think it's still the good ideas are still coming back under a different name. So I will never in my entire life say that COVID-19 was for anything a good thing. But it has helped a little bit, we have to admit that.
Yeah, never waste a good crisis. What like needs that. To be done for open education to truly take hold, in your opinion?
Well, we have to, it's a little bit there in my previous answer. So we have to, I think we have, what we still have to figure out is what's the precise relation between online teaching and live physical teaching. So what's the right balance between those two different things? So that's an important thing. That's an important thing. Why? To convince in particular teachers to do this kind of stuff. So it's not threatening your job, mm-hmm. because it's not replacing your job. It's making your job easier in many ways. My examples of this very simple kind of flipping the classroom is, I think, is important. Another part of the attitude, which I think we see slowly changing for the good as well, and that is the idealism which is behind this of the open access part, right? So because what I said before is not necessarily open access, that's just about being online. But seeing this as our goal to educate to some extent, not just our own students, but the world, that's another important key factor. And I'm optimistic about that. So I can see that this is, it's not going to rapidly, but it's moving forward. People see this more and more.
Yeah, I think I do agree. Like the example with the Indian girl. What are the most pressing challenges, you think?
So I interpret this question now to be a little bit, what are the most pressing challenges between some of the things I've already mentioned?
Yeah, right? Of course, you already mentioned some hurdles.
Yeah, right. Let me see. So one extra factor, I believe. So one thing which I don't think I've emphasized enough is this idea of competition between universities. Universities see their teaching. So I think, let's say our own university, Nijmegen, I think the board was justified in being a bit hesitant because they openly said, we are a campus university. We want people to be on campus. So we don't want people to be online. But below this is always, I suppose, a little bit, and understandably to some extent, the idea of competition between universities. So we don't want to give away our stuff because then people at other. So I've been doing this MOOC for Leiden, and now I don't know, some speech therapy department in America is using it. They're not paying anything because you don't have to pay for that. So is that justified that now the University of Leiden has invested in me and in all this material and somebody else can use it for free? That's the problem of the open access movement, I think, more generally, right? So who is in the end is going to pay? And we have to understand that every institution is paying for themselves, and we in the Western world may have an extra responsibility for this kind of setting this kind of step.
Yeah. And maybe this comes with responsibility of our status. What are your plans for the future with open education? Do you have any plans or nice projects? Looking forward to it.
Yeah, well, we do have there is a plan now for actually in the spirit of what I just said of cooperating between different Dutch universities. As you said in the beginning, I'm a professor of Dutch, and that sounds, especially to Dutch people, that sounds a bit local, but actually that is not very local. That is not very local in the sense that there is, I think, so the Dutch universities combined have about 150 freshmen for Dutch studies each year. Mm-hmm. There are two universities in Hungary which teach Dutch. Each of those universities have more freshman students of Dutch every year. So I think there's about 150 freshmen, Dutch freshmen in the Netherlands. There's about 13,000 in the world.
Wow.
So it's really more of an international enterprise than some people suggest. Mm-hmm. But those students, they don't have access to all the kinds of stuff. You know, it's the same story. They don't have access to all the kinds of stuff we had. So it's a one plan to make that happen. So to make a course, an online open access course for everybody who is interested in being up to date with what's going on in Dutch studies. So that would be an international MOOC in Dutch. That would be the idea. And I want to say, so for me, a MOOC is a real course. So it's not just a set of videos. It never was. It's a set of videos. It's reading material, which we provide. It's tests to test yourself. So it's and then it's a test at the end to see whether, and then you can get a certificate to do it. So it's the whole package, let's say, of teaching. And most of all, so I almost forget, but most important of all is interaction with fellow students. So is we have set up, it's still functioning, a whole structure of student assistants who are not necessarily studying linguistics, even who can answer some of the most basic or only technical questions which people doing the course might have, and then student assistants who know some linguistics. And so it's kind of a pyramid, and then I am actually on the top of the pyramid. And in these 6 years, I don't think ever any question has reached me, so it's never necessary. I have to say, nowadays I no longer do so often, but especially in the beginning I did mingle with them as well, and to have this kind of community of people, and that's another thing you can do online, mm-hmm. is an essential part of it too. Yeah.
Oh, I'm that's a wonderful idea, and I'm looking forward, and keep me informed, and let me
we
know.
We'll be happy
if we
to
can
work together
help
with the
as
library.
A library.
Yes, sure. Yes.
Yeah. I thank you so much for this interview.
Thank
Do
you.
Do you want to add something we forgot to talk about, or
is there anything we forgot to talk about? Yeah, so maybe I can mention one thing which maybe we touched upon but didn't. I can say two or sentence about more. Mm-hmm. And this, so I did talk about the interaction among students. I think one thing to at least think about for me, so teaching, for me in the end, teaching is really about communication. And communication means two ways, it goes two ways. Mm-hmm. So the involvement of the teacher in all of this material, it's, I mean, obviously you record stuff and that's then used and again and again, but I think a course is a dead course if the teacher is never involved in it. So you can, I said I'm at the top of the pyramid, questions don't reach me, but I don't think I can leave the pyramid. So if I leave, or I should be replaced with somebody else there, but there should be a people, teaching is about people. And that's what we should definitely keep, I think. And we always have to think about how that works.
Okay, thank you. I totally agree. Teaching is a human thing.
It's a human thing. It's a human interaction thing. Yes.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. I think we have reached the end of the interview. And thank you so much again.
Thank you.